A very good and beautiful morning to every one of our listeners of NASCO Moments Radio Talk Show, Old and New. This is the start of the third quarter of the year 2021. Because you have joined us today, you are making history as a listener and as a witness to the first episode of season 27 of NASCO Moments Show on radio. We promise to provide you and yours the quality life that you deserve in our thoroughly rewarding discussions on this show from today till the end of the season. By the way, how many times have you washed your hands today? NASCO cares about your well-being and urges you to prioritize personal hygiene and to stay safe. In a tribute following the death of founder of NASCO Group Nigeria, Alhaji Ahmed Idris Nasreddin, Nigeria's President Muhammadu Buhari recognized the pioneering role of the industrialist in the development of agriculture in northern Nigeria since 1963. He went further to say that the late Nasreddin was a man of vision who built the company from strength to strength and became one of the biggest employers of labor in the country. These eloquent remarks from the president no doubt mirror the extraordinary life of Alhaji Ahmed Idris Nasreddin, who died at an advanced age of 96. On the NASCO Moments show this morning, we begin the first of a two-part conversation on lessons in tenacity, integrity, and philanthropy. The life and times of Ahmed Idris Nasreddin, founder and pioneer chairman of NASCO Group, Nigeria. Our guest is Nde Ezekiel Gomos, OFR, chairman, economic team, to the executive governor of Plateau State. Nde Gomos was at one time, many years ago, on the board of NASCO as a representative of the Plateau State government. Nde Ezekiel Gomos, welcome to the show.
Morning and welcome.
Listener, don't touch that dial. We shall be right back.
Brightex White Detergent. Ever since I discovered the secret of Brightex White Detergent, my clothes come fresh, bright and clean always. It's mild on clothes and good for my washing machine. Thank you, Brightex.
Brightex Detergent cleans deep stains and dirt from your clothes, keeping it fresh and bright so your clothes don't fade. It lasts longer. Brightex White Detergent, a quality product from NASCO. Take the Brightex advantage today and keep your clothes fresh, bright and clean.
For your brightest wash, Brightex.
Brightex, for the brightest wash.
Welcome back. I'm your host, Hudun Gang, and you're listening to NASCO Moments. We're talking about lessons in tenacity, integrity, and philanthropy. The life and times of Ahmed Idris Nasreddin, founder and pioneer chairman of NASCO Group Nigeria. Part 1. Our guest is Nde Ezekiel Gomos, OFR, chairman economic team to the executive governor of Plateau State. Now, let's start the show on a personal note. Who was the late Alhaji Ahmed Idris Nasreddin, founder of NASCO Group Nigeria, to you?
I start from many parts. Alhaji Nasreddin was a dreamer, somebody who saw tomorrow clearly. He knew where he was going, and so he had a vision of where he wanted to go, where he wanted to take community and society to. Another part of him was that he was an adventurer. This is somebody who wasn't from Nigeria. He was from the then Ethiopia, but now Eritrea. And he left his country all the way, crossed all these other countries at that time, in the 60s, to come and settle, not in Lagos, which was the commercial capital of Nigeria, but in Jos, of all places at that time. So he was an adventurer. At the same time, he was a man who saw community, a man of community. He wanted whatever he had as a dream, he wanted to share it with the community he lived in. So I saw him as someone who believed not for himself, but for the larger community. In that instance, he built the organization called NASCO today. He was somebody also who believed so much in integrity. In fact, that was his driving force. Integrity, integrity, integrity. If you can't do something honestly with Alhaji Nasreddin, then don't go near him, because he was somebody who believed so much in integrity. That was some parts of the gentleman who he was.
Interesting. Now, in your encounter with him, what did you find very striking about him?
He was somebody who believed that tomorrow would always be a better day. And that was very striking. He could take risks, believing that that risk would bear fruit tomorrow. And in this society, that was new. A lot of people wouldn't take that kind of risk, investing everything because he believed in the tomorrow. And he was a pioneer. the kind of industries he focused on were things that people were not doing before. I mean, so to that extent, I mean, it impressed people around him that, look, if this guy could so believe in this tomorrow, then let's join him in that journey. He was that kind of person.
So he was able to get a good following then in that regard?
Yeah, he did, especially in the business community. Yes.
Now, what is today the NASCO Group Nigeria, started as a jute bag factory? Can you share with the listener the NASCO story as you understand it?
Like I said, it was a story of adventure and a story of a dream. I think Alhaji Ahmed saw that clearly, which many people didn't see. You see, in the 60s, in the late 50s and the 60s, Nigeria was a major grower of crops, cash crops, particularly northern Nigeria, and crops like groundnuts, cotton, etc. And so these crops needed to be bagged and to be stored before export. If you were not born then, but some of us who were then, we needed the groundnut pyramids in Kano, for instance. They were made up of groundnut bags, huge groundnut bags piled together waiting to be exported out of Nigeria. So, and then cocoa in the south. So where would you put, he saw from far that, look, all these crops needed to be bagged. And so he thought of jute bag factory. And it was in response to the federal government. At that time, the federal government, especially the Northern Nigeria government, under the late Sir Ahmadu Bello, the Sadona of Sokoto, they were looking for investors. And the investors that would also work with the agricultural sector of Northern Nigeria. And Alhaji Nasruddin answered that call. He was invited by the Northern Regional Government, but through the federal government. And he chose to come and set up as a joint venture with the Northern Regional Government then, the first jute bag in Jos of all places. And it was based on the local material. It was the plants that was planted all around Plateau, especially around southern Kaduna and part of Plateau. This was the raw material for this jute bag. So that was the dream, that look, all the crops needed to be bagged and the bag needed to be made locally. So that was the whole idea. In 1963, it was the first in the whole sub-Saharan Africa. There was none of its type. And that was a dream. That was a focused vision that he had.
All right. How would you assess the industrial landscape of Nigeria before the entry of NASCO and where the company is today?
At that time, you know, like I said, he was a pioneer. There were not many. Plateau province then was basically tin producing. So the only industry then was mercury smelting around that time. And then so his coming in was actually the first non-tin based industry, and that was also and it was based on agriculture, which was a major employer of labor. So he saw that connecting to the people, what people did, because not everybody was into tin mining, but almost everybody was into agriculture. So he connected that dot, that look, we needed to link up the industrial, and most Nigeria's industries at that time were agro-based. They were processing either in Lagos or somewhere in Kaduna, which was textiles. Kaduna was basically textile based, and Kano was textiles based on the cotton that was produced in the north. So I think that the backward integration then was very, very, was the right thing to do to add value to agriculture. Unfortunately, a lot of them don't exist anymore. The textile mills have faded out, and even the jute plant history, I mean, the jute manufacturing back in established 1963 has closed down, unfortunately, due to changes in the economy and other factors.
But would it still be needed today?
Oh yes, I think it more than any other time, because you see, the bags that replace jute, which is the polypropylene bags, the plastic bags, they are not biodegradable, meaning that they harm the environment. They are produced from fossil materials or petrochemicals, and so they're not even healthy to the environment. Now you find them all over the place. Backo bag remains. They don't rotten, so they spoil the environment, and they're not healthy. They are not healthy. They are cancerous in the long run. So we need to have that's what we need to have. And the polypropylene bags are not integrated to our agriculture. The farmers don't benefit from anything except you put products inside. But this one, the jute bags are based on locally grown crops. So that's why it's very important to have those industries back.
Okay, so but where would you place NASCO today?
I think NASCO has grown, like that used to be late Nasruddin's mottos. From little icons, we grow into mighty oaks. You know, he used to say that, and that was actually the catchphrase for NASCO adverts. From little icons, we grow into mighty oaks. Now, NASCO has today become a mighty oak in the landscape of Nigeria. It's the largest single employer of labor after government in Plateau State. That's a major, major achievement for what he started in 1963. And so I place NASCO as a major player. It has grown from not only manufacturing bags into manufacturing household products, food, several other things, into property, into several other things it's doing today. So NASCO has become a dominant player in the socioeconomic life of Plateau State.
Mm. Yes. And obviously has affected the landscape positively and economically as well.
Yes.
Ezekiel Gomez, thank you for your answers. So far, listener, it's still the NASCO Moments radio show. We shall be back right after this.
Mama Shakara, this your Ashebi still dey shine on. And how don't fit? How manage?
Ah, my sister. Now Brightex white detergent, oh. Brightex detergent not the fade cloth at all. And if they wash clothes clean well, it gets power to come out all the nyama stain and dirty no matter how it be.
You not go chop hand soup?
No, you know the chop hand, oh. And it good for washing machine too.
Mama Shakara, me too. Now Brightex detergent I go dey use to wash all my clothes now, so that I go dey shine and scent and make Shakara like you so.
Brightex white detergent, a quality product from NASCO.
For your brightest wash, Brightex.
Brightex for the brightest wash.
Welcome back, dear listener. This is NASCO Moments, and I'm your host, Hudun Gang. Our guest has been the Ezekiel Gomez, OFR, Chairman Economic Team to the Executive Governor of Plateau State. He was at one time, many years ago, on the board of NASCO as a representative of the Plateau State government. We are talking about lessons in tenacity, integrity, and philanthropy. The life and times of Ahmed Idris Nasreddin, founder and pioneer chairman of NASCO Group Nigeria. Now we'll be getting back to the discussion. Now, in your view, what are some of the considerations that must have made just Plateau State the headquarters of NASCO Group? I know you mentioned just before the break that we had some of the raw materials, but is there more to it?
Yeah, I think there was more. Ahmed Nasreddin, blessed memory, saw in Jos a cosmopolitan city, a city where everybody could live in. It was a welcoming city. Already Jos had, like I said earlier, had been a major receiver of European population due to tin mining. Not only European, but other Nigerians, Igbos, Yorubas, Urobos, every Hausas, everybody was living in Jos. So he saw that as a cosmopolitan city. It was the only city you could go in and feel very much at home. Then secondly, the weather was excellent. I mean, it's always been an excellent place to establish a factory. And the people were welcoming. The environment was a very welcoming and still a welcoming environment. So Nasreddin felt at home. And you see, Ethiopia is, if you look at Eritrea and Ethiopia, it's a fairly hilly and mountainous country. And which country presents him in a similar environment except just Plateau. So he saw that similarity. And of course, the raw materials were here. So there was a major, and additionally, there was a robust electricity supply. No other part of Nigeria had a stable electricity like Jos at that time, NESCO. So he saw all these advantages and he took it. And finally, the rail line connecting Jos to all parts of Nigeria, to the port. So it was good for him to come down here. Yeah, so he chose his Plateau.
I feel as if we should go back to those times, considering we don't even have rail lines coming to Jos, trains
well,
coming to Jos.
They'll soon come back to Jos.
We're looking forward to that.
Yes.
Now, looking back at the life and times of the late Ahmed Nasreddin, what were the qualities he possessed and what values did he promote?
First, integrity, I mentioned earlier, and sense of community. When he came up here, and to tell you how important he felt community was, he didn't want to invest alone. He wanted to share this investment with Northern Regional Government, which formed a joint venture of partners. And then when Benue Plateau was created in 1967, he met the then late J.D. Gomog and also offered the government of Plateau State a slice of NASCO, which has been a major earner for Plateau State through the Plateau Investment Company. So he had that sense of community. And to tell you how important he felt sharing his views and his benefits with community was, almost every single person who worked in NASCO would share at that time and even up to now, would tell you that it's a family. It feels like a family. Wherever you come from, you feel together. That togetherness was there. Those of us who were outsiders, we saw it in them. And to the extent that it radiated around people. Let me tell you, for instance, that when J.D. Gomog was trying to appoint his commissioners in 67, 68, one of the first commissioners was from NASCO. the commissioner, late Dauda Philip Ashu, was the staff of NASCO. And this trend continued. When Chief Solomon Lai was forming his cabinet, the late Chief Emmanuel Lai was commissioner for finance. When the federal government was forming a cabinet under Abacha, we had a minister from NASCO. We have had commissioners from NASCO consistently. I think the last time was Dauda Lamba from Wase. So that sense of community is always there. They felt part of the government. They felt part of the community. So that radiated from this gentleman.
Now, how have these qualities and values helped in transforming NASCO Group to the position of the market leader it is today?
I think when you have a sense of community, even the people buying your products will have a sense of ownership, because that's a key thing. I mean, people see NASCO as their own, you know, so that sense of community radiates into a market leader. Its products have remained consistent. We grew up seeing NASCO biscuits. It's consistent. It has remained there, out there, for so long. Many companies have gone under. In fact, even giants like who were competing with NASCO in some of the products, we don't see them in the market anymore. But this consistency has been carried on over. I think it's just to do with the founder's philosophy.
That's very interesting to hear. As a responsible corporate citizen, what impact has NASCO Group made on its host community, especially in the area of corporate social responsibility?
I think the first area we should look at is, as you enter JOS, after dropping from Dadinkoa, as you move in, you can't miss the beauty of that, the road from that roundabout up to the NASCO headquarters roundabout. That itself, and this, they've been maintaining this road in terms of beautification since they started. I mean, several governments have come and gone, but they've been maintaining it. The two roundabouts around that area is maintained by them, and so that's one major area. They've also created employment, lots and lots of employment in this area. Around so many people have been employed in NASCO. They've also contributed a lot to empowerment of youth, young people. At a point, NASCO was a major sponsor of the biggest football club in Plateau at that time, the Mighty Jets. So they used to be called NASCO Jets. They sponsored that. They've also built a number of community water supply programs. I know in Tunuwada, there's a borehole, there are boreholes they've done. They've established computer centers in conjunction with Apurimac at one point in Katako. In as far as Niger State, I know they have some programs going on there. They've donated so much to orphanages in Plateau State. Several orphanages have benefited from NASCO. In fact, there's hardly any single orphanage in Plateau, from Rafiki to Klapai to all the orphanages. I know they've donated materials, food. They've taken care of IDPs. They've done a lot in terms of I mentioned beautification. They've done a lot in terms of malaria control, tuberculosis programs, awareness. So in terms of different sectors of the Plateau economy, they do it. They don't make noise about it. They don't. NASCO is not one of those noisy companies that you hear. I mean, their CSR is quiet, and I think that's very why it's effective. Most people don't even know that road, that part of the road, maintained by NASCO. There's no signboard there that said this roundabout was built and maintained by NASCO.
But don't you think people will appreciate them more if they know the extent to which they have been contributing to society?
Yeah, that's true. But you know, you have to understand the philosophy of NASCO. I mean, the gentleman himself was not a loud gentleman. I mean, he was the biggest employer. He was a loudy. He was a very well-known person all over Nigeria. But you never saw him throwing around his weight. You never saw Amala Ahmed anywhere in a big ceremony shouting, "I'm NASCO." Even his son, the current chairman, doesn't do that. They're naturally people who prefer that the glory should go to God and let the people understand that. I think that's a good philosophy. For instance, when the Plateau State government attempted to name a street after him some time ago, and it was generating some controversy, the old man said, "Look, you don't have to do that. Don't force it. Let it be natural." And immediately, the street went back to old Airport Road. So that kind of thing. But some other people would have paid money to have their names plashed all over the place. But that's not NASCO style. The NASCO philosophy is to work, achieve results, and let the glory go to God. I think that's what they've been doing. And I think I prefer that. It's good to let people know, but people will get to know when they know that you are the one, they appreciate it better.
Yeah, how do you think NASCO as a company is perceived from the host community?
One of the things that you can tell is the fact that NASCO has remained strong up to now, over 40 years plus. And this tells the host community appreciates what they're doing. If you go to Channel 7 area, that's the immediate host community, they'll tell you, yes, they've been around with NASCO for quite a while, and they appreciate that. In some communities that I know of, the company would have a big gap between the people and the community. So that creates a kind of tension between the community and the, but the fact that NESCO has remained part of the community means that the community are willing to even protect it. During the last NSAS project, for instance, some people went to NASCO thinking there was, and they came out because NASCO people, they said, look, this is, even young boys came to protect NASCO. I saw some young people standing around saying, look, don't touch NASCO. This is our bread. This is our life bread. So don't go near NASCO. So this is to show you that when you live in the community and you behave as part of the community, they take ownership over what you are doing. And that's, I think that's what NASCO has continued to do.
Okay. Now, what are your parting words as we end this conversation?
It's for every organization, company, especially profit-making companies, to consider two things as a driving force. The integrity, it's a very important force, and the community is very, very important. You must be part of the community. You must continue to be relevant to your community. You must continue to make the community to feel a sense of ownership around you. That way you're going to grow. And you can become sustainable and you become relevant.
Ezekiel Gomez, we are very grateful to have you here today.
Thank you very much.
Dear listener, I hope that you have been educated and informed on the life and times of Ahmed Idris Nasruddin, founder and pioneer chairman of NASCO Group Nigeria. Next week, we shall bring you the second part of this conversation with another guest who also knew and worked with the late founder and pioneer chairman of NASCO Group Nigeria. We have to end the show here. Remember to follow NASCO's social media handles for all the exciting information that you can get. Visit www.facebook.com/NASCO Group, or you can freely send feedback on any aspect of this NASCO Moments radio show to the email info@NASCO.net or by text through the dedicated care line 0805-774-7777. Today on the NASCO Moments trivia, our question is, what is the mission of NASCO? If you know the answer, send it via text to 0805-774-7777. Remember to write your full name and exact location as well. The NASCO Moments radio talk show has been brought to you by NASCO Group. It was created by Unimark Limited, marketing communications consultants. Executive producers, NASCO Marketing Department, producer Haroon Audu. Research and content development, George Pang and Haroon Audu. Production coordinator, Solomon Audu, Deborah Galadima and Alex Rubin. Until next time, stay safe. Always wash your hands, wear face masks in public, practice social distancing, and always carry your hand sanitizer with you. My name is Hudun Giang, and this is NASCO Moments.